Let's go this way. Take a good picture of that house. That is the largest one you'll be next to today. We will go on a smaller barrel house towards the end of the tour. Barrels are a lot like kids. You can have two children at the exact same age, and one child is always more mature than that other child. Same way with barrels. So you're going to take 180 to 200 barrels, and you're going to mingle that together to get the consistent taste of old number 7. 7 starts off everything, and then it's the next step on what you do and what it will become. Tennessee honey, Tennessee fire, Tennessee apple, that's 7. You just add something to it right before it hits the bottle. Who's had Gentleman Jack before? Raise your hand. Gentleman is number 7, going back through charcoal a second time, only 3 feet deep. But y'all signed up for an angel share tour. That means you bougie. That means you drink your whiskey straight on the rocks with a splash of water. If you don't, I'm going to help you and convert you that way today. So majority of your alcohol is coming from the top of the house. And what y'all are tasting today is called single barrels. So only 1 out of 100 barrels will make it to be this whiskey. So every time you try a single barrel, it will have a different taste for you. And we'll go in more detail about that once we get to the safe wondering. Well, let's go this way. Y'all watch your steps. Jasper Newton Daniel was his legal name, but Jack, Captain Jack, was a nickname for him. Now, he's the youngest of 10 siblings, and his mama got really sick, and she ended up passing away. So his father decided to get remarried. Stepmother enters into the picture, and Jack, he didn't care for her. So he ended up leaving, and he was very young, around the age of 7 years old. And it wasn't odd for a boy that young to go live on somebody else's farm and work. He tried to live with an aunt and uncle. That didn't work out. So he ended up living with Dan Call. He lived about 5 miles from here in Mulberry, Tennessee. Now, Dan was a good store owner. He was a preacher, and he had a farm. And a lot of alcohol was being made on that farm. Now, this is around 1860. So around the Civil War and Emancipation time, Call's steels were watched and cared for by an enslaved gentleman, and his name was Nathan Nearest Green. So Nearest was Jack's mentor, taught him everything he knew. He taught him a process called the Lincoln County process. It's where you take your alcohol and you let it go through charcoal. Well, today, this is what separates us from them SOBs up in Kentucky. Them some other brands. So we don't buy charcoal, we buy wood. We're doing exactly what Jack and Nearest was doing. That's hard sugar maple. Comes from a sawmill about 70 miles from here. You leave it outside for 6 months to weather, take 4 stacks, goes underneath the hood. You have to have an accelerant to start the fire. What do you think that we use here? 140 proof, 70% alcohol coming straight off the steels. That's moonshine. You spray it on there, you throw you a match, it'll light straight up. It takes about an hour and a half for it to completely burn. So once it burns, it falls into a pile because those ricks are leaning in. And then the oxygen gets cut off. Darren and Tracy, they'll cool it down with water. So too much water too soon, you have wet and burned wood. Too little water too late, now you got ash. So what they want is a golf ball size. We can't use that. The whiskey would hit it, bounce off, roll around, and go straight to the bottom. So they take it and they grind it down in that building to a pea size. You take your pea size charcoal, that goes inside of a melon vat. Who has a Brita filter at home? Raise your hand. What's in there?
Carbon.
What's it doing to your water? Right, so these mellowing vats are oversized ancient Brita filters. All we're doing is getting rid of all you fatty acids and all your corn oils. So really our whiskey's healthy for you. Y'all just have to drink more of it. All right, let's go pick up your slushies that y'all purchased at the beginning of the tour. So here on the distillery grill, we can start serving it at any time. But in the state of Tennessee, a lot of your liquor stores don't open up on Sundays. And if they do, then they start opening up at 12. Thank you. Ooh. So it's just two gentlemen, and their name is Darren and Tracy.
That's it for everything? Two people.
Now they're training some younger guys because they're wanting to retire soon. Yeah. But they, Darren and Tracy, they've been working together for about 20 years. Thank you. Alrighty, so they're burning about 3 days out of the week is what they're doing. We'll use this charcoal for about 10 to 12 months. Old charcoal will end up going to Arkansas. Kingsford, the company, they'll pack it up for us as charcoal for your grills at home. So the one thing you'll learn about our distillery is we're 100% green. Nothing here is wasted whatsoever. Y'all watch your step. This pavement is not even. Somebody asked, is this where all the charcoal is being made? And yes, that's correct. So there's nobody else, there's no other company, there's no other place that's making the charcoal. All of our alcohol is made on this property, matured in a barrel on this property, and bottled on this property and shipped out here, okay? So we're gonna get started drinking, maybe a little bit earlier than what y'all tend on to. I'm gonna spray your hands down with 140 proof, 70% alcohol. And once it enters your hands, I cannot tell you what you can and what you cannot do with it. So if it goes up to your nose and you wanna smell it and something happens between there and here, then you will be okay, all right? After I spray you down, you're gonna exit out over here. Stand closer to the building for me. Sometimes we have traffic that comes up this way, so just kinda keep your eyes open. We'll start right here. Y'all go for it. Go ahead and exit out that way for me. Did Jack collect anything besides whiskey? I said, yeah, women. Because Jack had 7 girlfriends, so a girl for every day of the week, okay? Somebody asked about, do we have any protection for these barrel houses? And we do. Inside, there are up-to-date sprinkler system, fire protection. But we do have our own fire brigade here. There are 30 people on this team. Upgraded engines are kept just a half a mile down the road. So the largest pumper truck's on the east of the Mississippi River full of foam. So no airport has anything on us. So these two engines are both retired. The one to your right is the 1919 American LaFrance. One to your left is the 1928 REO Speedwagon. So the REO stands for Ransom Eli Old. That's where the guys are named. Alrighty. He's gotten in some trouble with a church and his wife. And they basically said, hey, you got to choose. Either you want the Holy Spirit or you want the drinking. So he chose the Holy One. So the seals come up for sale. Now, Jack, he'd been working on that farm. He'd been saving up some money, but not enough. And so he had to take out a loan against Dan Call. Rumors have it he bought the seals for $25, but he's about 13 years old when he does that. Now, he was 16 years old when he established the Steels in 1866. So we are the number one and oldest registered distillery in the United States. Now, there was a family that owned the land and they were going to sell. And Jack had heard rumors about a cave spring and about a water source that was flowing out of it. So he wanted it. So he decides to go to the bank. He buys 200 acres for over $1,000, and he didn't get here until sometimes after 1884. And he started making whiskey, and he's on up in his 30s by then. So where you're standing, a lot of history has been made. Jack only produced 8 barrels a day. He's trying to stay off the radar of the government. Now we're all over the radar. So we produce a lot more than 8 a day. But we're still using this water. So we've hired professionals to investigate. They've been about 2 miles back inside here, but it got so narrow for them, they were scared they were going to get stuck. So we're pumping this water about 100 yards back is what we're doing. Once the water exits out, there's no refiltration system. This rock is called limestone. So we catch minerals from this, and that is helping towards our whiskey. And also it's getting rid of the stuff that we don't want in there, like iron. You don't ever want to use water has iron in it to make alcohol. Makes it really cloudy and a dull black. Behind me is dry, and that's normal. When we get a heavy rain, like we do in the fall, or excuse me, in the winter and the spring, this will fill on up, and it's supposed to help with flooding, but it never does. So this still floods really bad for us. And no, it doesn't hurt production. They're still making alcohol. It just hurts the tourism. Okay? People ask, well, how many gallons are you pumping out within a minute to an hour? I can't tell you that, but it's a whole bunch, though. Okay? Questions? It's never ran dry. It's been flowing for over 150 years. We do have some underground reservoirs holding a lot of this water, so we're prepared if something does happen.
Do you build those reservoirs?
Mm-hmm. 2007 was probably the worst drought for us, and that really freaked them out. The water level got a little bit lower than normal, so that's when they started building. Any other questions you might have? All right, this ain't no wishing well. Yeah. It ain't no fountain of youth, and it ain't no river of Jack. Him, they thought, let's make him larger than life. He's over 5'7". Now Jack stood 5'2", and he wore a size 4 shoe. So in a woman's foot, that's a size 6. Now he went up towards Nashville, and he was doing some wheeling and dealing, selling whiskey, buying some products. Somebody recognized him, knew who he was. And they said, you need to quit dressing like a boy, you need to dress like a man. So he's put in a tailored suit, bow tied hat. He entered back in this town, nobody knew who he was. He had to reintroduce himself. We ended up getting 7 girlfriends. A girl for every day of the week. He was never married and he never had children that we know of. You ask my husband, he'd tell you he's the smartest man alive by not doing that. Okay? Now this is the only place in the whole county where you can get you a free shot of Jack on the rocks. So y'all hop up there and grab you a photo with him if you want to. And I'll be here all week, folks. Let's go this way when you get ready. Okay, so this is Jack's old office. This is the oldest building on the property. It was the headquarters for the distillery starting in the late 1800s, all the way up until 1952. And they built the other headquarters right across the road. And we'll see that when we exit out of the building. Now, Jack had a nephew, and his name was Lim Motlow. And Lim was a very intelligent young kid. Jack gave him a job, and he was open at this building every day. Well, 1905, that didn't happen. Jack has beat Lim into work. So he thought, I'd get the day started. He tried to open up the safe, and the more he messed with it, he realized that he'd forgot his own combination. Now he kept trying and trying, but he had the worst temper. And he hauled off, and he kicked that safe, Mr. Jack did. Well, he broke his big toe. Well, here comes the nephew. He opens up the safe. Well, Jack didn't want to tell him anything about it.
So he got what he needed, went on with his business. Well, about a year later, he's at the doctor. Gangrene has set up in the break of the toe. So now the toe is being removed and the infection is spreading. So they continue to amputate on Jack's leg. And then he lost his life in 1911 at the age of 61 years old due to blood poisoning. Moral to the story?
Never.
Remember your code.
Don't you ever come to work early because it kill you. So 2 years before Jack passed, he willed it to Liam. So Liam owns a distillery during Prohibition. Lots going on. Tennessee's in your Bible Belt. It gets shut down pretty quick. So now he's in Birmingham, Alabama, trying to make alcohol. It don't work out there. So then he's in St. Louis, Missouri, trying to make whiskey. And a lot's going on in St. Louis. People are breaking into his warehouses. Things are getting caught on fire up there. So he decides, I need to pack up and come on back home. So he opens up the Lynchburg Hardware and General Store. He's selling mules, farming equipment, everything he could. Man, he got really desperate. He got into politics. He got into local politics. Basically, he's trying to help vote Prohibition out of the state of Tennessee. So if it wasn't for Liam, we wouldn't be here today. He passed away in 1947, and it was willed to his four boys, Motlow Brothers. Well, they ended up selling the distillery off in 1956 to Brown Foreman. And the reason why is, in your early 50s, you had singers on stage like Frank Sinatra talking about Jack Daniels. You had movies coming on, and product was being shown. And we have a documentary called Chasing Whiskey. You can look it up on Amazon Prime. But in that documentary, it has an actor, and he said that he was acting like a bartender. They had all this product, and he said, they told me just to grab a bottle and start pouring. He said, the only thing I recognized was Jack Daniels because that's what my daddy drank. So for the rest of the movie, that's what you saw was a Jack Daniels bottle. Well, then you had commercials coming on. Jack Daniels was being seen. So business was booming, and then four boys, they were really struggling to keep up. So they decided, we have to sell it. They had so many corporations offering them all kinds of money. But Brown Foreman was family owned, and we believe that family is our quality control here. So that's why they sold it to him in 56 for $20 million. Brown Foreman, they still own us today. They own quite a few other spirits out there. Some big ones that are like our sister companies is Old Forester and Woodford Reserve up in Kentucky. So those are two names a lot of people know. And then they own wineries and some scotches, Irish whiskeys, tequilas, rums, I mean, a little bit of everything. Now, we are the number one selling whiskey in the whole entire world. And every drop comes from this town. So, welcome home and welcome to the source, okay? So, when you get ready, I want you to meet me over here on the other side. I have a little bit more history to tell you. And then we're going to go talk about how we make alcohol. That means you're getting closer to drinking. Let's go this way. So Jack gets here, and Nearest is on up in age, and he don't feel like traveling all this way. So his son, Nearest's son George, did work here on the property. We didn't have a photo of Nearest Green, so we put this up in his honor because we believe that is George sitting right there next to Jack, and Jack is the only one standing in the whole photo.
Standing.
Everybody else is just sitting down around them. So you saw Liam Motlow above the desk. Well, here he is in his younger years. Sitting in the front row. Here's another Motlow. His name was Jess. Then he goes to Lim's Holly, to Jess Gamble. He's a preacher too. Mr. Frank Bobo, he introduced Gentleman Jack in 1988. Some of y'all had drank that one before. Jimmy Bedford introduced Single Barrel Select in 1997. And then in 1998, we had our first person come in and buy a full barrel of whiskey for a little bit over $5,000. Now they're spending between $10,000 to $15,000, mm-hmm. depending on those state taxes. Now Jeff Harnett, he came out with the Tennessee Honey, the Tennessee Fire. He was in kind of control of 27 Gold. He retired and he got passed down to his assistant at the time, and that is Chris Fletcher. So Chris is our current master distiller. He's introduced 10-year-old, 12-year-old whiskey, Coy Hill. So those are some big names. A lot of your heritage bottles, he has introduced those. He's a generational worker. Mr. Bobo's his granddaddy. The Motlows and the Tollies
are descendants of the Daniels, and we still have the Greens working here as of today. So somebody was asking me earlier, they said, how long have you been doing this? I've been walking tours for about 5 years. I've been working for the distillery for 8, but I'm a generational worker. I'm not related to any of those men. My grandmother worked here for over 25 years on the bottling lines. My mom has been here for well over 15 years. So Lillian, my 8-year-old, she loves the smell of alcohol. So we're really working with her, and we're hoping she'll be working here soon. And then this baby will get it too when she starts seething. Let's go this way, y'all. Watch your step.
What about the Frank Sinatra?
What about?
Who started that one?
So, Jeff Arnett, he was here when that one was introduced, but we wanted to dedicate that to the Sinatra family because Frank really enjoyed Jack Daniels.
Right.
Now, we introduced the Sinatra Select first, and then the Sinatra Century came out.
Yep.
Yeah.
So, if you have the Century, I would never open it up. One, because it's worth a lot of money, and two, we won't ever make it again.
Oh,
the Select is a limited edition bottle, so one day it will go away, but right. We have some for sale inside the bottle shop.
Yeah, no, that is really smooth. I was just curious who thought of the name and
So we have, you know, we have marketing people, and a lot of those marketing people will work with the master distillers. And that is something that we have stuff that we've been working on for years, and we're just not allowed to say until it comes out.
Right.
No, that makes sense. Alrighty, so we're getting ready for the production area. You got to get these grains in, and by to do that, you got to use trailer trucks. So they're going to come in, they'll weigh right over here on the scales, and they'll drop off right over here at the grain mill. Number one yellow corn comes from the whole state of Tennessee, northern Alabama, and up in Kentucky. Number one yellow is what separates us from other distilleries because they're going to be using number two. We use over 100,000 bushels of corn in a whole week. Malted barley comes from Montana and Idaho. There's two enzymes that we're looking for that will eat at the starches in your corn, turning that into sugars, turning that into alcohol. Your rye is coming from Canada, eh?
Yeah.
Eh? Because that is the best rye out there, and they're really well known for making rye whiskey. So we'll buy the best from them. And that's gonna bring out your spicy notes. These 12 silos were built right after Prohibition back in the day and hold your grains in there for weeks. Today it's less than 12 hours. So that really shows you on what kind of scale we're on. Now, we're gonna start with the malted barley and the rye, cave spring water. It's gonna go in something called Big Bertha. Big Bertha, she's making our yeast mash. Next ingredient we add in there is our lactobacillus that is grown in our lab. And that is a bacteria for that yeast mash to thrive off of. And then that will go into a yeast tub. Bertha will fill up 5 of them at one time. We have 18 in total. So it sits in there for about 16 hours. You take it out, you send it off to fermentation. And we have over 60 tanks in there. The yeast tubs will fill up 2 fermenter tanks at one time. Next ingredient you add in there, the rest of your grains, is some more water. All of this is going to ferment, work with each other for 4 to 6 days. And then after that, you're going to take it out and you send it off to distillation. 40,000 gallons in each fermenter tank. It's a 5-to-1 ratio. So 5 gallons of mash makes 1 gallon of whiskey. Leftovers is what we call slop. We pop it up to the hill. Farmers, they come and get it. They feed it to the livestock. So we got a lot of happy cows and some drunk pigs around here. So distillation. There's 4 stills that you see right there, and they're 40 feet tall. And inside, there's 18 copper plates. So think about them as oversized colanders. Your mash goes up, it gets released, and it drops down, where steam comes in from below and it hits that mash. Alcohol vapors are coming off. You grab, you cool, you condense at the top, you turn that into a liquid, you have your 140 proof, 70% alcohol. 2 larger stills, they produce about 40 gallons per minute. Or 2 smaller stills, they're producing about 20 gallons per minute. Now, we are going, tomorrow creeps into our yearly maintenance period. 1 month out of the whole year, we have to shut down. It has to fix stuff. So starting tomorrow, for the next 3 days, we won't give any tours. because they're about to pave this whole distillery lane. So then they'll come in and they'll have a contracting group that comes from all over the state, and they'll replace copper and things like that. So when they get done paving, then you'll have them come in. So you won't see any alcohol being made right now just because of that. Every distillery does this. They have to. They have to fix stuff. And normally throughout the year, we put a big Band-Aid on it. And then we have to stop and actually fix it, okay? When we enter inside this building, we ask for you not to have your phones out. We want you to keep your phones put in your pocket. And the reason why is that's a ticking time bomb ready to go. Even though there's no alcohol being made, there's still alcohol vapors in the air, all right? Now, this is where the stairs come in. Is everybody comfortable with climbing quite a few stairs at one time? Okay, let's go this way. Y'all watch your steps. Else's bottle right up the road about a half a mile down. So if you traveled in like from Fayetteville, Tennessee today on Highway 50, you actually saw that other bottling facility. Y'all come on in.